Hey everyone, Brady from Texturelabs.org here, and today I'm going to run through a tutorial on this crazy magical smoke text effect in Photoshop. It's a method I came up with when I was working on some of the marketing for this movie called Pan. Yeah, that's the one. And this look actually never made it anywhere, but I held on to it because I just think it's a really cool technique, so I'm happy to share it with you guys. Anyways, this looks pretty insane, but it's probably not built the way you might think. There's no painting involved at all, just some really interesting things going on with layer styles and blending modes, so let's jump into it. All right, I've got a new document going here, and I already have just two things in here. I've got a black background and a layer of live type, which is white. This is a font called Tondu, and I'll include a link to that. This document, by the way, is HD resolution, 1920 by 1080. This'll work at a higher resolution, but I'll just keep it simple. I'm gonna start by bringing a texture in here. This is Texturelabs Atmosphere 195. I'll also include a link to this below. Kind of a cool wispy smoke, so I'm gonna select all and make a copy of that. Then back in the main document, I'll paste it in over the background. And I'm gonna do a quick transform and just scale that down to be about the width of my canvas. And I will rename that one Smoke. Okay, so this smoke texture is gonna kind of drive the whole look. We're gonna do some interesting things with it. I'm first gonna use this texture to displace the edges of the type. So generally you might use the displace filter for that, but I'm gonna use kind of a weird method that keeps everything live. I'll start by selecting this text layer, and in the effects menu down here, I'm gonna apply the stroke effect. And in stroke, I'll reset to defaults, then I'm gonna change the fill type to gradient, and I'll bring the size way up to about 150. I'll change the position to center, and then here in the gradient style, I'm gonna set this to shape burst. It's almost like it makes the type super blurry, right? Which seems totally useless, but just hold on. I'm gonna hit okay, and then I'm gonna drag that text layer into its own group, which will kind of isolate that stroke effect. All right, next I'm gonna want a copy of this smoke texture. So I'm gonna hold the Option key, then click and drag a copy of this smoke texture to the top, not into that folder, but right on top of it. And I'm gonna apply one filter to this smoke. It's all the way down in Filter, Other, and it's this one called High Pass. And this can be a really useful filter. With it, you can eliminate the big variations in dark and light across an entire image and just focus in on the smaller details. So if I set this to about 30, that leaves me with these nice swirls, but they're very evenly distributed across this texture. So, okay. Then I'm gonna hold the Option key and click in between that smoke texture and the group folder to create a clipping mask and place that texture just within the shapes of those letters. And here's the key to the whole thing. I'm gonna change the blending mode on that texture to hard mix. And look at that, it ends up creating all this displacement based on the smoke texture. I'm gonna do one thing, I'm gonna bring the fill of that layer down just a touch to 95%. And that'll make that edge a little bit softer and more natural. And check this out, if I open that folder and double click on the stroke effect, I can change the size of the stroke effect and control how crazy those edges get. I'm gonna leave that at about 150, and I can also experiment with these edges by selecting this texture, and I can move it around or I can invert it with Command I, and inverting it kind of distorts things in the other direction, and I actually like that a little bit better. Then, to make this white and transparent rather than white and black, I'm gonna right-click on the group folder and go to the blending options of the group. And here, I'll hold the Option key, and holding Option is kind of crucial here. Holding Option, I'll drag the This Layer black slider all the way to the top, making the black areas transparent. Okay, so moving along, next I'm gonna take these two pieces, the folder and that texture on top, and drag these into yet another group folder. And that kind of bakes these layers and these settings into one piece. All right, next I'm gonna take the smoke texture and start to go a little nuts with it. I'm gonna need three copies of it. I can hold Option and drag a copy right above it, or I can use the shortcut Command J, and I'll do that again so I've got three copies. Then I'm gonna hold Shift so I can select all three of these and drag these up on top over that group folder. And let me rename them. I'm gonna call the bottom one Smoke Fill Color. I'll call the middle one Smoke Overlay. and the top one I'll call Smoke on Top. Then let me turn them all off and I'll run through them one by one. And first, I actually want this background smoke to be quite a bit more subtle. I'm going to select that layer and bring the opacity on this one in the background back to about 30%. Then back up to this smoke fill color. I'll turn that one on, and then I'm going to option click between that and the group folder to create a clipping mask so it'll just fill the shapes of the letters. Then I'm going to select the group folder and I'm going to apply a few effects to it. I'll go to my effects menu and first I'm going to use Inner Glow. Here I'll reset to defaults, then crank that all the way up to 100% and bring the size up a bit to maybe about 40. Then let's add another effect. I'm going to click on Outer Glow. I'll reset that to defaults, then bring the opacity up to about 55% and the size way up. I'll try 200 pixels. Then one more effect, I'll use Inner Shadow. I'll reset to default, then bring the opacity all the way up to 100, crank the distance up to about 50, and let me reverse the direction of that. I'll change the angle to negative 90 degrees, because I want that shadow to fill kind of more the bottom of the letters. And then I'll soften it out. I'll drag the size all the way to the top at 250. And one more thing, I like the way this looks better if I change the contour tab here to this kind of S-curved profile. Now the settings here, particularly on this inner shadow, I'm kind of just eyeballing based on how they look for this font. With a different font or different size letters, you might need to push these values around and kind of find a nice balance between shadowy and glowy areas, but that's looking nice and moody, so okay. And if you're enjoying this tutorial so far, please do hit that like button. I really do appreciate that. And be sure to subscribe. I've got a bunch of ideas for new tutorials that I'm going to try to get to, so be sure to hit the alarm bell to be notified when anything new goes live. All right, time for some more magic smoke going in here. I'm going to turn on this smoke overlay layer, and the only thing I'm going to do here is set the blending mode on that one to overlay. And finally, this smoke on top layer, I'm going to get a little fancier with this one. I want some smoky details that kind of sit on top of the letters. I'm going to double click on that layer, which is a quick way to get to the blending options. And then I'm going to use the blend if section. And blend if can look really cool with smoky elements. First, I'll drag up the underlying black slider and create some transparency based on the background. Then I'm going to hold option and split that little slider, which smooths out the transition. And then on the this layer slider, I'll bring down the white level and create some more transparency in that smoke. And same thing, hold option, split that up and kind of smooth out the transition a little bit. And I'm kind of just pushing these values around and finding a balance where some of the layer is transparent and some of it is kind of obscuring the letters in a way that looks cool. Something like that. So okay. And that's a subtle one, but if I turn it on and off, I do think it helps glue the foreground and the background together, kind of create these smoky areas that sort of wrap around the edges of the letters. All right, I'm going to drop one more texture in here before getting to some color. I'm opening this Atmosphere 149, which is actually a snow overlay, but I think it'll double as some magic particles. I'll copy that, and I'll paste it all the way on top, and let me do a quick Command-T to transform, and scale that down to be about the same width as my image. All right, and I'm gonna set the blending mode on this layer to Linear Dodge. And Linear Dodge is one of the blending modes that looks better if you dial back the fill rather than the opacity. That's only the case for, I believe, 8 of the blending modes, but Linear Dodge is one of them. So I'll leave the fill at about 65%. All right, everything's looking good. It's a little dark overall, and I want a full spectrum of dark to light values in here, so I'm going to drop a levels adjustment layer over everything. I'll go to my fill and adjustment layers menu here and create a levels, and all I need to do here is drag the white input down, and that'll brighten the whole thing up a little bit. And finally, let's get some color in here. So to add some color, I'm going to use the adjustment layer called Gradient Map here in my adjustment layers menu. This is a perfect image to use a gradient map where I can assign totally new colors to the image based on whatever gradient I select or create here. Some of these presets are kind of cool, but maybe a little too strange. I'm going to create a custom gradient, and I'll start with a very basic default black and white gradient. Then I'm going to click in the middle to add a color and click on the color button. And I'll go with a very nice saturated medium blue. And then maybe I'll add a color in between the dark values here. Give the shadows just a tiny bit of purple. And I'll add one more color and shift the hue of these brighter values just a little bit toward green. And you could really spend all day experimenting in here with the color. There's no one right way to do it, but I'll save this gradient as a preset and include a link to it if you want to download and import this same look. For now, I like how this is looking, so I'll hit OK. And that is basically the whole thing. And a really nice thing about the setup is that this text, which is way down in the original folder, is actually still live. In fact, pretty much everything about this whole look is still live, so there's plenty of room to experiment and try different things from here. If I landed on a look and I really liked it, I might do one last thing, make a flattened copy of the entire image by going to the very top of the layers and using the shortcut Command-Option-Shift-E. I actually don't know where that is in the menu, but that shortcut creates a flattened version of the entire image in one new layer. And the only thing I'm gonna do here is sharpen it up a little bit with a filter sharpen unsharp mask. And I'll crank that up a little extra just to make it really clear with the amount at 100% and the radius at 2. All right, well, there we have it, the finished image. Kind of a crazy technique, but I hope you guys like it. If so, please do hit that like button and be sure to subscribe for more of this kind of thing on the way. If you use this technique to make something, post it up online and tag Texturelabs in it. I'd love to check it out. You can find these textures and much, much more at texturelabs.org. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.